seconds. Squadron.
Welcome back to the MMA Takeover on the LoudMouth MMA Podcast Network. I am your host, Keith Schillen. I am a writer for SureDog.com and CageSidePress.com. I'm also the executive director of this fine network at LoudMouth MMA. So we got a lot to talk about this week, the world of MMA. While there has not been any fights due to this global pandemic that we're all dealing with, MMA has been in the forefront of the sports industry with all the news around UFC 245. We're going to get to that in a minute. I just want to tell you what's going to happen in the show. We have a fantastic guest, one of the best journalists in the game, one of my best friends, Nolan King. He'll be in the second segment. But now we're going to talk about the top five news stories of the week. Now, I actually already recorded this segment, and then the world got flipped upside down with different news, particularly UFC 249. So I am re-recording this. Unfortunately, while I was ready to re-record, my mic broke, so I had to go to a backup mic. So hopefully the quality is still well. But let's get to the top five stories. I had a couple of things I was going to talk about. Anthony Smith's run-in with a home robber. I was going to talk about Cody Garbrandt's talking about moving down to flyweight. I talked about that on the last week's episode of Last One Standing. So I decided, you know what, in the world of MMA, the only thing that people are talking about is UFC 249. So my top five stories are going to be all pointed toward UFC 249. So let's get to it. Number five, I'm going to go in. We've already found out that it seems like we will have an event April 18th at the Hitachi Palace in California with the headline of Tony Ferguson versus Justin Gaethje for the interim title. But what I want to talk about is later on Monday evening, right before we were going to record Last One Standing, the UFC announced the entire lineup. I'm going to read you the lineup. The lineup consists of fights that was already booked for UFC 249, fights that was already booked for other cards like the UFC Columbus card and other cards that got canceled, and then we had some fights that came out of nowhere. So this is the 12 fight lineup. I'm going to put a pin on one of them, but I'm going to start from the bottom, work my way up. We have starting the card, Ryan Spann versus Sam Alvey, obviously a veteran. Sam Alvey versus Ryan Spann, a really good prospect in the light heavyweight division. That's the fight that's starting the card. Next card, Sajara Eubanks, a girl that I've always been high on, never really lived up to hype. She's going against tough Sarah Marais. Michael Johnson at lightweight again. He is taking on Kamaru Worthy, the guy that pulled a huge upset in his UFC debut. Prelim card, a fight that I absolutely love. Marlon Chito Vera versus Ray Borg at bantamweight. That's a tough one to pick. It's a really fun fight. Next one, Alexander Hernandez versus Omar Morales. Morales, if you know from the Contender Series, he picked up a win in his UFC debuts. He's undefeated. Alex Hernandez is a guy that had a lot of hype, kind of got stopped by Donald Cerrone, but a guy that, and I believe he might be in the UFC rankings near the bottom of the top 15. If not, he's right on the cusp. Middleweight clash, which is striker versus grappler. Hanato Jacare Souza versus Uriah Hall. And then the main event of the ESPN prelim card is a fight that could, I mean, it was scheduled to headline, what was it? Not UFC. It wasn't Columbus card. Yeah, UFC Columbus. Francis Ngannou versus Jairzinho Rozenstruik, a fight that I think many people are expecting a brutal knockout. That is headlining the ESPN card. Moving on to the main card, Jeremy Stephens versus Calvin Kattar. I think that's a fight that the hardcores are loving. The power of Jeremy Stephens, the precision of Calvin Kattar, open up the card. A banger between Vicente Luque versus Nico Price. I mean, that is almost guaranteed to end in some kind of stoppage, as both those guys are big, heavy hitters, love to brawl. Really fun fight. Greg Hardy returns He takes on Jorgen De Castro, a guy who's actually local to me, and a, you know, Greg Hardy, obviously a big name from his time in the NFL and his run-ins with the law, a guy who's done, you know, much better than I think a lot of people expected. He's got a tough test in Jorgen De Castro. The co-main event, I'm going to put a pin on this one, but we were scheduled to for Jessica Andrade versus Rose Namajunas, rematch of their strawweight title, which Jessica Andrade became the champion when she slammed Rose Namajunas in the second round, knocking her out cold. And then the main event, Tony Ferguson versus Justin Gaethje for the interim lightweight championship of the world in a clash of two of the most violent guys, two of the most exciting guys in probably the history of the sport, main eventing. So that's the card. So you can argue, should the card happen, you could argue, you know, morals of what's going on right now. But I don't think you can argue with the quality. Now, you might say, well, it doesn't have that huge name. Tony Ferguson never really sold. He was the B-side to Habib. Sure. You could say Justin Gaethje's never headlined. Sure. But from a talent sense, top to bottom, I think pretty much every single fight I'm excited about. There's not one fight where I'm like, I'm not interested in that one. I like all the fights. I think there'll be knockouts, submissions. Guys make a run. Obviously, the winner of the main event will be a champion. There's going to be other people, but setting themselves up. I mean, the four title shots or four top five opponents. I mean, Nagano and Rozenstruik, the winner of that, probably gets a title shot after that. So, I mean, it's a really, really compelling card. And I think it was very smart of the UFC to put Nagano versus Rozenstruik on the ESPN card to kind of draw in the eyeballs. Probably getting a knockout, maybe introducing one of these heavyweight sluggers to fans that normally wouldn't watch, people who are dying to watch sports, people that would normally at this time be watching baseball or some other sport. They can might tune into to watch ESPN to watch UFC instead. So I like the construction of the card very much. I think most people do. So let's get to my number four story. This is a movie that just broke a little while ago. It's really why I'm retaping the whole thing, is the news that Rose Namajunas is already out of the co-main event. Combate reported this. They reported undisclosed reasons. We don't know. I don't want to speculate too much. It could be an injury. It could be whatever. But if it is because of the COVID-19 that she doesn't want to fight based on all the things going on, I really hope she doesn't get the treatment that Khabib Nurmagomedov got, where he went to Russia after being told the fight wasn't going to happen in America. He went to Russia. He went to Abu Dhabi, where he thought the event might happen. Couldn't get in there. Went back to Russia. Now there's travel bans. He's stuck there. And the fan, you know, so many fans are just stupid. The guy who's, in my opinion, the best pound-for-pound fighter in the world, a guy who's undefeated, a guy who's been as dominant a champion you could ever find, dominant fighter. I mean, the guy's lost, I believe, in his career, he's lost one round, the Conor McGregor, I think it was the third round of the Conor McGregor fight. And people still saying he's scared. And I mean, this is a guy when he was like 6 years old wrestling bears, but people saying he's scared. I hope Rose Namajunas does not get that. Now, Rose Namajunas is someone who's been very upfront with her personal anxiety issues. I know she got a lot of anxiety during the Conor McGregor Dolly incident in Brooklyn, where she was supposed to fight Joanna Jędrzejczyk. Oh, she did fight Joanna Jędrzejczyk in the co-main event, the rematch of the first fight where she won the belt, despite saying that she wanted to pull out and she had a lot of, she was really shooken up by the incident. She performed great. She beat Joanna Jędrzejczyk in a fantastic matchup. So that said, it could be an anxiety thing again. It could be, you know, worry about what if I attract disease? What if I come home and bring the disease to family members or grandma or whatever, and it spreads? Anxiety is an issue, and with a lot of people, mental illness is an issue. I'm not saying she has mental illness. I'm just saying, generally speaking, the brain can do these things to us and change us physically. And I don't blame Rose Namajunas one bit. If you're not 100% confident, you're not 100% feel like you're ready, if you're worried about outside factors that could affect you in the cage, this is a sport where you can get seriously hurt if you're not ready. You got to go against a fighter like Jessica Andrade, a girl who's a killer, a girl who already beat you for the title, a girl who picked you up, slammed you on your head, knocked you unconscious. This is her first fight back since that incident, which since that matchup, which occurred back in, I apologize, I should have had this pulled up, back May of 2019. So it's been just under a year since they last met. So if it is with the COVID incident, then I think she should, I mean, she should get a pass even if it is injury, but I really hope people will give her a pass. Don't call her, I mean, it's, no matter what, some idiots are going to call her scared and this and that. But anybody who's not going to work, anybody who's taking precautions, extra precautions, whatever, good for them. Put your family first. And if Rose Namajunas is doing that, then I applaud her and I think she should get a pass. Moving on. The number three biggest story of the week, I almost put this one number one because of how crazy it is. Dana White did an interview with TMZ, and he announced that there will be a couple fights at that time. He said undisclosed location, which we now know is Tachi Palace in Glenmark, California. But he said that he has secured a private island, and he plans on holding events there. What the heck are we talking about? If you told me this story, you know, as if you told me this story on April 1st, which we just had less than a week, just over a week ago, I would have thought it was an April Fool's joke. Just take the scenario for a second. You have a worldwide pandemic. During this pandemic, you have a leader of a sports organization, a multi-millionaire, decides he's going to avoid the pandemic, keep his, and buy a private island, rent a private island, secure a private, whatever you want to say, travel to a private island and get his fight, like basically put on a fight club in these private islands. If you tried selling this as a movie plot to Hollywood, I think you would get thrown out and you'd be like, how unrealistic, how stupid. Almost has like a Hunger Games type feel or something like to it. What world are we living in? I want it to happen because of just how crazy, how great of a story this could be. Yeah, man. I know John Anik has been saying, don't doubt Dana. Dana was saying, don't bet against me. If he can get his private island and this happens, he gets fighter's degree fight and he can put on the cards and we can watch it on ESPN Plus and UFC Fight Pass and he gets guys to go over there, Dominic Cruz and Daniel Cormier and John Anik and these guys to commentate and gets quality referees, your Herb Deans and your Mark Gardards and this stuff to referee this. Dana White, way to go. My number two story is the actual main event. It was announced Monday afternoon that the fight, the main event, will be Tony Ferguson versus Justin Gaethje for the interim title, a title that Tony Ferguson's already had, never lost. Regardless, they're going to fight in the main event five rounds for the interim title. I think it's a risk for both guys. Tony Ferguson's taking a huge risk by taking on such a challenge against Justin Gaethje. What is his reward? His reward's going to be Khabib Nurmagomedov, a fight that we've had booked five times now. It just seems cursed. It's not going to happen. And you're taking on an absolute killer in Justin Gaethje. But I actually disagree with most people saying that the biggest challenge, the biggest risk is on Tony Ferguson. I actually think it's on Justin Gaethje because Justin Gaethje's taking this fight on 12 days' notice. He did an interview with Brett Okamoto and he said, well, he might have had closer to 19, 20 days. I still say we have in the whole thing 3 weeks' notice to train for Tony Ferguson. Justin Gaethje is the guy who's gone on record and said that he does not like taking short notice fights. And he, during that interview with Brett Okamoto, he mentioned that he believes he has 18, 19 minutes of high-paced fury, and then after that, he doesn't really know what's happening. So you're already saying that the last round, you probably have nothing left. Maybe a portion of the fourth round, you have nothing left. But who you're getting matched with? You're getting matched with Tony Ferguson, the guy, you know, a couple weeks ago, one of the guys in one of the MMA groups I was in, I believe it might have been the MMA Takeover group, posted, like, make your perfect fight. It wasn't make your perfect fight, but it was basically who has the best in insert attribute, like punching power, Muay Thai, offensive wrestling, whatever. And one of the categories was cardio. And my pick was Tony Ferguson, other than maybe Kamaru Usman, Colby Covington. There's like a handful of guys that are in this conversation, but Tony Ferguson is 100% in the club, as my friend John Franklin would say. There's like a club of guys who qualify, and Tony Ferguson is in this club. You're going to take on Tony Ferguson with 3 weeks' notice, not having a full camp. Who knows what your camp looks like? Now, I know there's stories that he did some training sessions with Drew Dober sparring, but you're not having a full 8 week camp. Some of your training session, he said, is running on a treadmill downstairs. It's, getting some one-on-ones with some coaches, but still, I mean, how quality can your training camps be without, the big, six, seven sparring partners, a couple guys to grapple with, a couple guys to wrestle with, whatever. I'm concerned for him. He's a guy that has gassed out in the past. You think about the Poirier fight, you think about the Eddie Alvarez fight. And I shouldn't say gassed out, but it's definitely slowed out because he doesn't pace himself. He comes out in a fury. He's coming out looking at Rock'em Sock'em. He wants to brawl. He wants to test each other's chins. He wants to see whose chin will fall first. While I think Tony Ferguson is obviously very hittable, he's been rocked in pretty much every single fight. Edson Barboza hurt him. Lando Venata hurt him. Anthony Pettis hurt him. Kevin Lee was beating him. Everyone kind of has early success against Tony Ferguson, but somehow he survives. Now, I believe Justin Gaethje could clip him and take him out in the first round, but if he doesn't take him out, every minute that goes on, I believe it goes from advantage Justin Gaethje to advantage Tony Ferguson. The deeper it goes to the fight, the more advantage it's going to go to Tony Ferguson. I'm happy that, well, I'm going to get to that in a second, but, obviously I'm excited to see this fight. I mean, who isn't excited to see two of the best fighters in the world go at it, two of the most exciting fighters? I just would have rather have seen an 8 week camp than a 3 week Justin Gaethje. So let's get, and this is the other reason why I think he's taking a risk, besides it's going to be a tough stylistic matchup. One of the news we got when the rumors started that it might be Justin Gaethje getting brought in, one of the things that was put out there by Errol Hawani of ESPN, he said that there was talk of Justin Gaethje versus Conor McGregor at International Fight Week. Now, obviously, if Justin Gaethje wins this fight, he puts himself first in line with Khabib, but he might have lost the Conor McGregor fight. Now, obviously, he is focused on the title. He wants to be the best in the world. But I don't know, man. You get a chance to get Conor, the biggest star in the sport, the biggest payday, the thing that can make you a star. I mean, think about what Conor did to Nate Diaz. If he loses that fight, the Conor fight is probably off the table. If he wins that fight, he's next to Khabib's, the Conor fight's off the table. Yeah, he to me, I would have just sat back, taken the Conor fight in July. But you know what? It wasn't 100% official. I believe nothing was signed. So maybe he was looking at it that I can't pass up a chance with Tony Ferguson with a hope for Conor McGregor. I might not get it. It's not 100%. So maybe he thought otherwise. So the last thing I want to say, UFC 249 going down April 18th in Glenmore, California at Tachi Palace. You know what? I am still not 100% convinced this is going to happen. The White House predicted, I think it was earlier this week, that the peak is coming really soon. The scientists and doctors are predicting that it could be the peak in America could be April 16th. Now, I don't follow politics, and I shouldn't call the coronavirus politics, but I don't follow the national news as strong as I could. I'm by no means an expert on pandemics. I'm not means an expert on politics. I try to stay away from politics. I think politics divides people and brings people together. I really, as I've gotten older, really try to stay away from it. So by no means am I an expert. Don't take any of this. I could be talking on my ass. I could be misinterpreting things. So please don't. But from my understanding, we haven't got to the worst of it. And if it is the worst, 2 days before the event's going on, what kind of message are we sending? We're shutting down schools, we're shutting down churches, we're shutting down businesses and all these kinds of things. We're telling people, if you go to the grocery store, cover your face up and don't talk to people and try not to interact with people and try not to touch things. If you take a package of cheese, buy that package of cheese, don't put it back. Don't try to, limit your germs. And what kind of message are we saying if we're going to let fighters grapple with each other, battle each other during this pandemic? While a part of me is obviously super excited, I want to see fights. Nobody wants to see fights with me. A part of me feels like it's very irresponsible. I am one of these guys. I'm on the fence. I'm not taking a really high moral ground, like some people are saying that there's no way this should happen. And then there's the other people saying, God, just let them bleed. This is what we need. I'm really torn. And I think that's normal. Like, I think you should feel torn. I feel like as an MMA fan, you want to see fighters fight. You want to see fighters get paid. I mean, these guys need to get paid. But as a human being, being part of this world, this is not an American problem. This is not a Chinese problem. This is the entire world problem. And I think we all need to be doing our part. So that's why a part of me is like, man, maybe we shouldn't be doing this. Maybe we should be staying back. Maybe we shouldn't. We should be social distancing. We should be trying to do everything to beat this pandemic. And I don't know if the UFC is doing that with UFC 249. Anyways, that said, I'm still excited to see fights. And if the worst thing that happens is we settle for fights, then so be it. Anyways, guys, I'm going to take our first break. Those are our top five news stories of the week. We go into a short break. We'll be right back with MMA Junkies' own Nolan King. Stick around. All right, guys, we are back. Second segment of the MMA Takeover. It is the guest of the week portion. The guest of the week is one of the best MMA journalists in the entire business. One of the nicest guys. He's, you know, I'll just be honest. He's one of my closest friends in this industry. Maybe my closest friend. He's the great Nolan King of MMA Junkie. Nolan, what's going on, my man? How you doing?
Good. How are you, man? That was quite the introduction. Might have been one of the nicest things you've ever said to me on one of these podcasts publicly.
Well, it's funny because people have said this to me that every single show I do, I show a different personality. Like if this was our last man standing, as you would known as Between the Links, I would have insulted you as you came in. So I try. Like this is my nice guy one, and MMA yesterday I'm a little nicer, different ones, but yeah. Nolan, before we get to anything, how's everything going? How are you handling this COVID-19? How's the self-quarantine? All that going?
You know, man, it's funny. It's definitely has its downside. I think it's tough for everyone. But I was joking the other day with somebody. I was saying I'm the only one that Monday through Friday my social life has improved during this whole thing. Having everybody working from home, and it's been interesting. It's kind of kept me in line, and having almost nothing to do has made me just focus on the basic things that I need to do in my life. So it's got me in line. It's obviously really boring, and I'm hoping things turn around, but I'm surviving, man. I'm surviving.
Yeah, I was saying on last one standing that I'm looking at a lot of positives. Now, obviously, I can speak for both of us. We don't want to see anybody getting sick. We don't want to see anybody die. But, you know, being home, spending more time with my family is a good thing. Obviously, we both love MMA. We're passionate about it. It's probably both of ours number one hobby, passion, I mean, whatever you want to call it. But having a little break, I don't know about you. Obviously, you got to keep writing, but I a lot of my writing is focused on events. By not having events, it's almost like I had this extended vacation, and I feel almost refreshed by it, by not being, you know, get a little more time to watch a movie or spend some time with my kids. It's kind of nice. So I'm kind of trying to look at the positives.
Yeah, no doubt. There, like you said, it's kind of making you realize what's important. And I'm not too optimistic that everybody's gonna be those people that take, you know, don't take anything for granted after this or whatever. But I think there's going to be a certain appreciation people have for like the everyday things, like going to eat at a restaurant. You know, if you talked about 6 months ago, it's like, oh yeah, that's just an every week thing. And now it's like, when is the next time I'm gonna get to have like, you know, a sit down meal and not in my house? So it's been crazy, man, but hopefully there are some positives that we can draw out of it. Obviously a lot of negatives, but I'm sure something good can come out of this.
All right, so let's get to it. UFC 249 is expected to go down April 18th. It was announced yesterday. Dana White announced the main event. Tony Ferguson and Justin Gaethje will be battling for the interim lightweight championship of the world. Later on in the evening, the UFC broke the entire card. Some fights that we expected on it, some fights that we didn't expect on it. All in all, I think from a hardcore perspective, it's a card that I really enjoy. I mean, top to bottom. When you got Ryan Spann open up the card, I think that's the guy that both of us I know are high on as a prospect. That's a good card. That said, we both in agreement that it's a good card. As you're nodding your head, should it be happening? The morals part of this, should the UFC be putting on this event?
You know, I'm going to say no. They shouldn't be putting it on. If I felt like there's a number of different layers to this, and I feel like over Twitter and through other conversations, I've been able to kind of touch on a lot of these things. But, you know, the big one's obviously the health risk that comes with this. There's a reason that everybody's shutting down. All the leagues are shutting down. You know, on one hand, I feel like I almost can't comment on that because we don't know exactly what the UFC is going to try to do in terms of that. Like, you know, say Dana White shells out a ton of money and buys tests from a private company. And, you know, I don't really know what they're going to do, so I can't criticize them too much. But just to me, it seems like the options that are available, there's nothing necessarily at this time that would suffice or be totally safe. You got people traveling from all over the place. You got them cutting weight. Their immune systems are already low from dehydrating their body and not eating right and all that stuff. So there's a lot of health risks. There was a lot of issues during training camps. I mean, a lot of these guys are having 50% training camps, so to speak, or 75% training camps. So when they get in there, how are they going to put on 100% performance? So there's a lot of different angles to this, but I'd say overall, I don't discredit the fighters or anything, but I think that this, I mean, in any other sport, this would never happen.
Yeah, no, as a MMA fan, obviously we're excited. We're dying to see fights. I mean, Justin Gaethje is as exciting a fighter as it's ever been in the history of sport. Tony Ferguson, it can match him in that aspect. You got two of the most exciting fighters in history going at it for five rounds. I mean, we got to be excited about that. But as I just said in the last segment, we have schools closed. We have churches closed. We have businesses closed. We have, right now, as we speak, the Prime Minister of the United Kingdom, Boris Johnson, is fighting for his life to survive this. There was a study, and the White House has confirmed this, that they believe the peak of this in America could be the 16th of this month, 2 days before. To be that is going to be the peak, and then this is going to go down. It's crazy. I mean, you got fire and police only responding to life and death, you know, tragedies. They're telling, hey, take an online report and different things. We are living in, and as everyone has said over and over again, unprecedented times. And to think that this event is going to happen is, to me, is absolutely mind-boggling. So let me ask you this question. I am still very skeptic. I'm still thinking way the news is. Doctors, scientists, they're not sure how this is going to, you know, how this pandemic, and I am not a doctor or anything like that, so I am not speaking from an authority, but how confident are you that this actually happens? I mean, we have a place now, as Jeff Sherwood was the first one to put out the news that it was going to go down at Tachi Palace, Tachi Palace in Lenmore, California. It has been confirmed by the New York Times, as all the media sources. I saw the Body Lock has gone out there. Other people are reporting it now. So all that said, we have a card, we have a location, but how confident that, you know, give me a number, 50-50, 60-40, how confident that you actually goes, you know, actually happens?
Yeah, it's kind of a cop-out. I mean, 50-50, because I feel like I don't really know. I have no idea, man. You know, I feel like I have as – usually when I come on here and if somebody asks me, what do you think the chances of this happening or that, I feel pretty confident in my answer. But with this, like, there's just so many ins and outs of it that I don't know the logistics of how they would make it happen. I don't know what the options are. I don't know what type of roadblocks exist. And we haven't seen – obviously, this is also new. We haven't seen anyone of this magnitude, of this status try to put on an event like this, so it's hard to tell if you can do it. It's not like a lot of people have failed, a lot of people haven't tried, so it's difficult to say. And obviously I think the location, the fact that we're a week and a half plus out from this event, and now people know where the location is. I think there's a reason that the UFC was trying to keep this on the down low, you know, obviously to prevent or have the smallest amount of time in between when people find out where it's going to be and where it's when it's actually held, to try to make sure that no roadblocks, you know, found their way in the mix. There aren't any groups or government agencies or anything that come in and try to stop this. So, I mean, I think with the announcement tonight, I would say that their chances got a little bit less, but it's so hard for me to tell. I literally have no idea.
Yeah, I think we're both to say about it is a part of me wants it to happen. A part of me doesn't want it to happen because, you know, we have to be responsible. And what are we teaching people? You know, we telling people don't go to the hardware store, don't go to the parks, but let's watch fights. To me, that's kind of crazy. The other thing that came out, and Dana White, I can't even believe I'm saying this, but Dana White did an interview with TMZ where he basically announced, and I'm still not even sure if he's trolling us. He seemed like he was being serious, but a part of me just think, like, this is a great troll job. Is he said that he has secured a private island, and he's going to be flying fighters in to fight on this private island, specifically some of the international fighters that can't get into America. I don't know what question I'm trying to ask with this, but is this the?
I think I know what it is. What planet are we on?
Yeah, is this the? I mean, doesn't this seem like a D-level bad movie with like billionaire? There's a pandemic going on. A billionaire buys a private island. I know they're not going to buy it, but secured a private island, and then there's going to be a fight club on this private island. Like, is this the craziest shit you've ever heard?
Yeah, it seriously is, man. I don't know who had this on their MMA bingo card in 2020 at the start of the year, but I'm not sure that they made bingo cards with this option on there. This is crazy, man. I mean, if you had dropped me, you know, the me from 6 months ago on into today's reality and said, look at this headline right here. Like, it is just mind boggling. I mean, the fact that Habib and Ferguson was a casualty in this whole pandemic, you know, the matchup itself, like, it's just craziness, man. You couldn't, that fight is so cursed. And now we have Dana talking about an island. Like, it's just so wild. You know, I do take him at his word that that's probably the plan. You know, the way that he did that interview and everything, but this is just, it's going to be nuts, man. I can't even put it to words, you know.
It's funny because I was saying how, obviously as an MMA fan, I want fights to happen, but as a human being, I want people to be safe. I want people to listen to the experts, practice social distancing, try to get this, you know, for my family, for my loved ones, for your family, your loved ones, for, I mean, everybody. I want to see practice social distancing. But then when I start hearing about a private island, I'm just like, God, I want this to happen because how crazy. Yeah. This will be something we'll talk about 20 years from now. I was thinking about that meme, and I know you've seen it, where it was when we still thought it was Tony and Habib, and it was Dana, and they were in a bubble on like the moon, and he was looking over. The private island has got to be one step below like happening on the moon. Crazy. I don't know. It's like something.
Yeah, that's so true, man. You know, you hit it on the head because for me, I'm like, I don't feel good about like rooting for this to happen. You know, I obviously want everybody to be safe and I don't want anything bad to happen. But, you know, I'm like, if it happens and I don't have any control in the matter, like, am I going to watch the shit out of it? Yes, like 100% I'm going to watch it. I'm going to watch it hard, you know, and it's yeah, I mean, it's just so like, say that this pandemic clears up. This will be a very bizarre time in the sports history, like just very weird. I mean, it'll be really hard to top this.
Sure. The only thing that would be better is if they open up to media and MMA Junkie sends Nolan King to cover it. Like, would that would be the icing on the cake.
Yeah, that would be wild, man. I don't know what kind of laws they have there. I don't know if Dana will be able to take me in the back room and beat me up or something. But it'll be interesting. I can't wait to see it. And you know, again, I'm not condoning any of this, but it's just such a unique time in the history of the sport.
Yeah, all joking aside, if you could, would you even want to cover this, you know, live in person?
Something I thought about, you know, in terms of like when they were figuring out like where they were going to hold 249, you know, I was thinking like, you know, if they open it to media, would I want to go, or would we have somebody else go? We have John go. And you know, for me, I kind of, when I was going through the process in my head, I mean, I'd probably lean towards no at this point in time, like, you know, reassess week by week, stuff like that. But I just felt like the amount of limitations they have of who they can bring in that building, I don't think I'll have to worry about too, yeah. Like, you know, the upcoming events, yeah. As far as the island goes, that's a whole different story. Again, I would have to see what kind of precautions and what kind of stuff we're dealing with before I would ever make a decision like that.
Yeah, just to pull back the curtain a little bit, I was thinking about a month ago, me and you were hanging out at Mohegan Sun for a Bellator card, the one that was supposed to be headlined by Pitbull and Pedro Carvalho, also Emmanuel Sanchez and Daniel Weishel was going. It was part of that Grand Prix. And just a month ago, we were both sad that the event got canceled. There was a rumor that maybe, all right, it's going to be closed to the public, but it's going to keep, I mean, it was going to go on closed to the public. Then, oh, you know, maybe the media's going to be allowed. And we were, like, fighting to try to get in. And now a month later, we're, like, the opposite. Like, I don't know if I would put myself in that situation either to cover an event. Well, you know me, I love covering events. You love covering events. It's like, and I think that showed as a society how much we've come and how much we've realized how serious this is. We're like a month ago, we were like, overreacting. Like, what's, you know, so yeah, going back, I'm gonna get to the actual fights, but the last thing I think of is when someone came up with the private island, like, it just seems like two friends hanging out, getting high, and be like, smoking a joint, and be like, dude, I know what they could do. Dana's got a lot of money, and he could just, like, rent, like, a private island and then just ship the guys into there. Like it didn't seem real.
You know, and I think that we started to approach that debate when we're trying to brainstorm feasible yet crazy ideas. They're saying, what if they held it on a ship, or what if they held it in the mountains up in Russia, or, like,
yeah.
You know, what if they did it in a grain silo? I think that, like, the island thing was – it was past the point of being a joke, because if you said that, it wasn't even funny, because there would be no chance that this would be the case. But it ends up being that it was an off the board option, and here we are.
So let's talk about the actual fights. We have a fantastic main event: Tony Ferguson, Justin Gaethje fighting for the interim title. I don't care if it's for interim or not; it's a fantastic fight. I'm assuming you're probably the same boat. You don't care if it's. The title doesn't mean anything to you, right?
Right.
Okay. So let me ask this question. I think both fighters are getting a lot of credit from the media, from the fans, for taking a risk. That said, who is taking a bigger risk, in your opinion, Tony Ferguson or Justin Gaethje?
I mean, it has to be Tony. I mean, think about the stakes that he has here on this fight. He has the ability to, you know, say he didn't fight on this card. The logical next fight for him would still be the title against Khabib. Now he's fighting for an interim title, which is great. Like, he'll get that championship pay if he wins, no matter what his next fight is, as long as he has the belt and they don't strip him again. But he's fighting it's not like they're bringing in the number 10 guy or the number 15 guy to fight him. Like, they're bringing in Justin Gaethje,
sure.
Who is in the on deck circle to have a title fight. He's, you know, him and whatever happens with McGregor, like, this is a super, super legitimate fight. And it's just, to me, like, it seems to me like if Tony wins this, he pretty much ends up in the same place as where he started. Like, sure, he's got, he'll get paid pay-per-view points for the next card, and he'll get to have a two-time interim champion next to his name. But overall, it's just getting him back to the start of this camp.
Yeah, and I also think – I agree with you. When it comes to the risk factor, I agree. And also, if Tony wins, what's going to happen is he's not going to get a lot of credit. He's going to get a lot of, well, Gaethje took the fight on 3 weeks' notice, you know, Tony – you know, which is the reason why I think Gaethje has a lot of risk, because you're a guy who's gassed out in the past, guys against Dustin Poirier, against Eddie Arbour. Not, I shouldn't say gassed out, but slowed down. You said in an interview today with Brett Okamoto, you can go 18, 19 minutes, and you don't know what's going to happen after that. And then you're getting put up – against Tony Ferguson, who is the cardio machine. And as much as Gaethje's saying I know there was video of him getting some rounds in with Drew Dober and his stuff, but then not doing a full training camp, not an 8 week camp, obviously with the social distance, it's not an ideal situation. And it's not ideal for Tony too, we should say that. But stylistic, this is a really tough matchup to come in off the street. So if he wins, fantastic. If he loses, you know, I think he'll get a lot of credit from some people, but some people will say, oh, another loss for him. He fought a top guy. He lost again. So I usually like to ask this question at the end, kind of builds the suspense, but I'm going to do it right now because I'm talking about the style. Who wins?
You know, in the 24 hours that I've had to think about this fight in depth, it's so tough because, like you said, the style matchup, like, they're both so unpredictable. That's the problem here, is that it's not, there's not necessarily a trend line. Like, they've both, Tony's obviously been more successful in the win-loss column, but there's been times where Tony's also gotten beaten up and been close to losing. So it's a game of inches. They both like to be daredevils and go out there and put their own safety at risk to try to pick up an exciting finish. So, man, it is tough. I would say, honestly, the X factor for me that's making me lean like 1% in the direction of Justin Gaethje is the fact that he seems to have figured out how to still be exciting but fight smart. And I think that for me, seeing his calculated finishes the last couple of fights, they're as quick as they were, you could tell. Like, the IQ is there, but I don't think he was using it before. He just turned that switch on. And for that, he's been more active. I have to lean with him. I'm not super confident. It's a close fight, but honestly, one of the main factors too is I think as MMA fans, we can have nice things, and Habib versus Tony is just too nice for us to have. And this was just going to be, big time spoiler.
Yeah. Imagine. So we personally have experienced the Habib Tony, fights. We were going as fans which was scheduled their fourth fight. We just said, this is so good. Neither of us was coming for anybody. You weren't with MMA Junkie at the time. I'm not sure if I was with the Sherdog or not, but we were sitting up in the nosebleeds and we were going to see Tony and Habib, and instead we got Habib versus Ali. We probably would have made a joke that, oh, it's going to get booked again and then a pandemic is going to break it up. Like that would have been seen crazy. So you're leaning towards Justin Gaethje. I will give my prediction next week, but I think people can tell by the way I've already broken down which way I'm leading. So I hear a lot of people saying this, that it's perfect timing for the UFC to kind of strike while it's hot, get the attention of people who are looking for sports. The only thing else they got is like Tajikistan soccer somewhere, I think, is going on or something like that. So
we watched the other day, it may or may not have been a replay. We're not really sure, but we watched axe throwing, the Canadian axe throwing.
Canadian axe throwing.
Or something.
Yeah, I think that might have been. I know I was following someone on Twitter who was breaking down, I guess NBA players are playing video games against each other. And I saw someone giving betting advice on it. And I was like, man, that's crazy. That televising,
that is wild.
Video game playing. So a lot of people expect this to be a very good selling card because of that. But then there's the other argument is right now this is, there's so many people out of work. People are tight on money. Obviously, restaurants are closed down. Businesses are closed down. There's the other argument that this will be a complete flop because people can't buy. Which camp are you in? Do you think it's going to be very good business for the UFC or not nearly as what they expect?
I think it would do good business. I know that there was the small sample size we had with the Brasilia card where – that got bumped up to mainstream ESPN, and people weren't thrilled with the rankings, the ratings on that. But I also think that you got to realize that that event was simulcasted, so you still had a big MMA crowd that was like, "This is UFC on ESPN Plus, so that's where we go. We watch it on ESPN Plus." There wasn't like that's what I did, for example. But I could have turned on the TV and just watched ESPN. So I think that those numbers weren't necessarily an accurate representation. And then also, I mean, this card is, you know, 15 times better in terms of name recognition and excitement factors. You got Greg Hardy on there, Francis Ngannou, the Rose versus Andrade rematch. Sure. So this is a big selling point. And I think at the time that the Brasilia card happened, people weren't as hungry for sports as they are now. It was still new. We said, okay, we didn't have the NBA for, you know, 5 days or something. Now it's like there's no sports on. There's been no sports on for 3 or 4 weeks. This is the time. I think this time around the UFC would do much better, viewership wise.
Yeah. There's a lot to wrap that. I think you hit a lot of good points. The fact that I believe the early prelims that wasn't on ESPN was still on ESPN Plus. So all us hardcores,
correct,
we're going to go watch. We're going to watch from the very. I don't remember which was the first fight, but we're going to go watch the very first fight, and we're going to we're not gonna switch over. We're just gonna. I went to ESPN Plus. I'm working. I'm streaming it on my TV. Why am I gonna switch over to ESPN now? I'm already there. So I get that point. And also, I think another big thing that happened was the NBA just closed. MLB just announced they were closed. So there was a lot of focus from SportsCenter and these talking about that. How is the NBA get affected? What's gonna happen with the playoffs and that? So Brasilia kind of flew under the radar. Like, it wasn't, like, really in focus. But next week, if this fight goes on, this is a big card. It should be getting more attention. Because how many more times are you going to talk about when's the NBA playoffs going to start? Or how many times are you going to do a story on MLB is going to hold all the events in Arizona? So I think that alone, I mean, if get a stream of Tony Ferguson doing an interview. Maybe not Tony Ferguson. Do a stream of Justin Gaethje doing an interview. You know, get Rose.
Honestly, I think what helped a lot too is the island talk. Like, that threw people. Now everybody, sure. You know, crazy article where Dana White says there's going to be fights on an island in a few months or in 8 weeks or whatever. Like, everybody's. I'm sure every article that was read by these people that have no idea see that he's going to try to put on an event in a couple weeks. So I think that as crazy as that was, and whether it happens or not or whatever, certainly put more eyeballs on the fact that the UFC's trying to press forward and that there could be live sports for people to watch.
Well, I also think, and I know this is not going to happen, and I'm just saying because we're on the East Coast, but one of the arguments here we said was they like it on the West Coast time frame, but starting at 10 o'clock on the East Coast, kind of fit in the West Coast when people still go on the nightlife, the whole Vegas vibe. Well, Vegas is shut down, Los Angeles is shut down, Oakland, San Francisco, all these cities are shut down. So put it on at a normal time, put it on at like 7 o'clock our time in the East Coast. I think that would make a lot more sense. Another thing you keep hearing, and I'm going to get you out of here soon, is a lot of people saying, well, we got to make up fights. Like, there was already three UFCs canceled. Bellator has canceled the entire month of May already. They had their card in March that was canceled. So there's a lot of fights that got canceled. One thing I keep hearing about the UFC is that they're going to still – they got these guys on contract. They owe these guys fight. That people are saying that there might be multiple fight cards a week, because after UFC 249, it sounds like they're going back to their normal schedule, right, which is almost every week. Or if we don't, you know, once in a while, we have once out of 10 weeks, we get a break off. Like, there's either going to have no breaks, or we might have to get multiple cards in a week. Now, as a hardcore fan, I don't care if there was a card every single night of the week. I mean, I'm going to watch. But could it backfire in the UFC if this does? Now, this is just rumors and fans talking. But could it backfire with this oversaturation that people, you know, while there isn't events going on, they're still, it's hard to follow. It's hard to keep track of what weight class is and that. So could it be a bad thing?
Like you said, I'm obviously a big fan and I'd watch whatever they put on. But for me, I think that if they stick with the same schedule or approximately the same rapid fire schedule they have, like, you know, it's almost to the point where you get a card every week. So I think that that's a good pace. And I also am kind of curious to see, and I kind of mentioned this on a live stream I did earlier, but I'm interested to see what happens with the roster in terms of, how many new fighters are they going to bring on? You know, are they going to let these other guys stick around for a little longer?
Yeah.
It seems like that's kind of the move. Like, there's some fighters popping up in discussions that I would have thought would have been cut, like that type of an ordeal. And a lot of the guys that were scheduled for London, Columbus, and Portland, they seem like they're going to be the first ones to be pegged for these to fill in. I mean, no, I'm not saying this is a good thing, but in the UFC's eyes, it's beneficial that they are such an international sport, because the London, the Portland, the Columbus cards, those, all the international fighters from those cards, they don't have to take up a roster spot with them. They don't have to have this sense of urgency. Damn, we got to get, you know, Jack Marshman to fight, because Jack Marshman can't fight right now. So I think that those, the American guys, or the fighters that live here or American citizens, you know, or train here, whatever, that they'll be the ones that are pegged up first. We saw with the Columbus, obviously, few matchups moving to elsewhere and to UFC 249. And I think that will continue. I think we'll see a lot of those fights just get booked for the upcoming cards and kind of fill in the gaps where they can.
Yeah, you, there's a lot to unwrap there. One thing you said was that we've seen other fights that weren't supposed to be on UFC 49 in Brooklyn get added to it. Francis Ngannou, Jozena Rozenstruik was obviously the biggest one that we could think of. Greg Hardy and Jorge De Castro was another one that wasn't on Brooklyn. That guy moved over. I believe that
and
was
then, the round. Sam Alvey was actually supposed to fight Roundtree on this card for 249, and yesterday that's when it switched to Span. So that was another one that got brought over, but then before it got announced, they put in Spann to fight Alvey. Yeah.
So as we've had some fights get saved, we've also lost fights. Of all the fights that we have lost, and hopefully Tyron Woodley and Leon Edwards gets rebooked or something, you know, of all the fights we've missed, and you can include Bellator if you want, you can include any organization you want, what is the one fight you're like, man, I'm most disappointed about this fight not happening?
That is a great question. You know, some of the fights that got rescheduled obviously were the easy choices for me there. I kind of bummed for Leon Edwards, honestly. My pick would have been Francis in Rosenstruck, but that obviously got rebooked. So I'm kind of bummed for Leon Edwards because it's kind of funny. You know, obviously he is an international name, so that's why he's been not included from these discussions. But you've seen what's been going on with Covington and Woodley going back and forth and people promoting that fight like that should be booked right now. And it seems like everybody's just kind of like, that was Leon's big shot. It took him a while to get there. It wasn't the sexiest fight, I think, for the UFC to make. And, you know, who knows what his future holds. So, in a sense, I hate to see a guy that's so talented and has earned his due finally have that swept out from under him.
Yeah, the other one that really jumped out to me is the return of Will Harris. I think everyone in MMA was rooting for – I don't want to say rooting for him to win because we don't do that, but just rooting for a good thing to happen in his life and getting back to fighting would have been a good thing. So – I'm a little bummed about that. When I first reached out to you to come on the show, I said I didn't expect to have this news. So we had to take a change. But I wanted to talk about your contender series articles. You did a whole series. You did every weight class. You said these are the 10 fighters in a weight class that deserve to be on the contender series. I don't want to give away all the stuff right here because MMA Junkie deserves some clicks, and we wouldn't do it justice this time. So, guys, make sure Nolan. I'm a big contender series guy. I do previews for sure, dog. Nolan did a fantastic job. I agree with pretty much every one of his picks. Give me one guy. So you went through every single weight class, heavyweight, flyweight, everyone, and you gave 10 guys. Give me one guy. If you got hired by the UFC today and they said, Nolan, we're going to put a contender series. Who should we put on? Give me the one guy. All the list, you're like, this is the guy. And he doesn't have to be the best talent. It could be entertainment. It could be whatever. But this is the guy or girl that you would put on the card.
Yeah, that is a really great question. The thing when I think of who is the perfect fighter for Contender Series, you know, we've seen fighters in the past that are a little overqualified to be on the show. And they go out and they, you know, murder somebody, that poor guy,
like
that
Ian Heinisch or something like that. Somebody
should already been in. Like decapitated.
Miles Johns.
Yeah. Right. So sure, those, like, I'm not, this is not a who do I think is the best fighter. I think who is the best, like, who fits the mold the best of Contender Series. And I think a lot of times I see guy when I think of that, I think of fighters who are trying to prove that they're ready and have a lot of potential.
Sure.
So for me, there's a kid out of Texas named Leo Minor Martinez. He goes by Mana Martinez, actually. And he, I think, is one of the most exciting fighters that I had the privilege of watching during, you know, looking up tape and stuff. And he's somebody that's flown under the radar. He's been fighting for Fury FC out there. He's still super young. I think he's like 23 or 24, 22, something like that. Karate style, has fought, you know, he kind of took a step up in competition in his most recent outings and has passed them with flying colors. So that's somebody I'm really excited to see how far along they are, because I think he's going to be really good.
Yeah, Ben Duffy is a guy from Sure Dog. He's from that area. He was talking him up too. So he has been getting some attention from the media. Two of the best writers, you and Ben, both giving this guy some love. A guy that I'm excited about being, you know, if we're going to have Ben talking about his regional guy, I'll do one from our regional guy. You know who we're talking about, the guy I always talk up. Vinicius De Jesus, that's a guy that I know both of us have seen him fight in person. He's a fantastic. And I think, like I said, I think you made a great point. Not the greatest talent, but a guy that is right there, deserves a test, entertaining, some of the best leg kicks in all of MMA, regardless of weight class. That's a guy that both of us, I can speak for both, I'm really high on.
No doubt.
My last question before I get you out of here, and I appreciate the time going way over. Nolan, so we have all this break. Both of you and me are still not 100% confident that these fights will go on. So a lot of MMA fans have a lot of downtime. Besides going to MMA Junkie and reading every single article, because that was going to be your answer, and going to Loudmouth MMA and listen to every single podcast, what's one thing if an MMA fan said, "Hey, Nolan, I really want to get more into MMA. Is there a fight? Is there a documentary? Is there something that you're going to say, this is what I want you to do. I want you to check out fill in the blank."
Yeah, that's tough, man. I think that there, like you said, there's a lot of different fights that you could go down, a lot of roads you could go down. There's a lot of documentaries that you could go down. If you're just looking for kind of a fun, quirky watch, I've seen some people give out their suggestions of like kind of fights that, it's not the Henderson versus Shoguns of the world or Diego Sanchez versus Melendez or these really wars, but I've seen people kind of give out fun suggestions, like Kaposa, who's a great follow on Twitter, is posting, Chad Griggs versus John Volante and Conan Silvera fight, stuff like that. So,
Yeah, sure.
kind of a fun card that always sticks out in my head that I always overlook, and I came across it the other day was the time that the UFC most recently went to New Orleans, and it had the small cage, and it had a ton of finishes. I think almost the whole card was finishes. So, if somebody's looking, to just sit
Who
back, kind of look at some
headlined
fights
that?
that maybe aren't shoved down your throat per se. That would be a good one. So you could sit and watch it in a short amount of time and get some good action.
I don't remember who headlined that card.
So it was Henderson versus Boech, I think, and then it had
Oh,
like
yeah.
Adrian Rothwell, Francisco Rivera, and Alex Caceres. I think if you looked
Sure,
at it,
sure.
like every fight was exciting, and they had again, it had that tiny cage that they did for a little while. So that's kind of a card that I think in MMA history has flown very under the
Sure.
radar.
If you're looking for like a fight to watch, Santiago and Misaki fight is one of the all-time fights that never gets brought up. It's one of the best fights ever because it didn't happen in the UFC. It gets overlooked. But if you want to look, I mean, it's right in there for all-time best fights. And if you're looking for a documentary to answer this question for you, probably my favorite documentary when it comes to MMA is one that a lot of people have not seen. It's called The Gracies and the Birth of Vale Tudo. What I love about it is it goes a real in-depth on the Gracies. And but the best part of it is not just a 90-minute, they are the best. They get into some dark things about the family, specifically Helio. Like it's not, it's, it tells you the whole story. So that's something. I can't remember where I used to watch it, but if you look, you could find it. It's called The Gracies and the Rise of Valetudo. That's a really, really good documentary. Nolan, go ahead.
And I have one more suggestion
Sure,
too,
go ahead.
off the visual track of suggestions. Actually, a couple weeks ago, I bought Josh Gross's book, Ali versus Inoki,
Okay, there you
and
go.
that's something that I've always tried to get better at learning MMA history. I'm only 25, and I feel like I've kind of had to learn backwards. Try to look at all this stuff, and we've talked about it before. It's hard to kind of get the essence of a moment in time. You can read about it and you can look through results, but it's tough. And so I obviously trust Josh as a historian, and I picked up his book the other day, and I'm a couple chapters in, and it's pretty good, man. I think it's good. You can support somebody that's a fellow journalist like us that's a good
Yep.
guy. So that's kind of been on my radar as well.
Yeah. That I believe Judo Gene LaBelle was the referee of that fight. So he's an icon in the sport and one of the first good guys, one of the first legendary martial artists to really give love to MMA. So yeah, and Josh Gross, he's absolutely fantastic. So make sure you check out that. Nolan, dude, you know you're my man. I appreciate the time. Most of all, man, stay safe. And to all you and your family, please stay safe.
Hey, dude, you too. Appreciate it, buddy.
There you guys have it. That is Nolan King, MMA Junkie. Make sure you check out all his writings, MMA Junkie. Also, go over to his Twitter. If you don't follow Nolan on Twitter, I don't even know if you're an MMA fan. So make sure you head over to Twitter and follow Nolan. And guys, I'll be right back. I'll be closing out the show. Stick around. All right, guys, I just want to say thank you to Nolan King of MMA Junkie. He's absolutely fantastic journalist. He's, as I said in the intro, he's one of my best friends. He's a guy that we became friends at a show a couple years ago. We were at a CES MMA show. I followed Nolan King on Twitter. At that time, he didn't have his face out there. He kind of used, like, I think he used, like, symbols and stuff or whatever. He didn't really have his face on there. And I looked at my Twitter while I was at CES. I was sitting at Press Row, and a guy tweeted out, "Oh, I'm here at CES." And my name was Nolan King, and I tweeted, "I'm at CES," and I didn't know what he looked like. So I looked down the row of people working, and you know, the local media is different than national media, worldwide media, the people who cover UFCs and stuff. And I was trying to figure out who it was, and then at the very end, I saw a guy with his head down, typing on a computer, head popping up, popping down, popping up, popping down. And I saw a guy hustling during the event while all the people were talking, and I said, "That's him," because he's one of the hardest workers. I went up to him. I said, "Hey, you know Nolan King?" He said, "Yeah." And I said, "Oh, man, hey, man, I follow you on Twitter." If he knew who I was, we kind of chatted. I said, "Hey, man, if you have a chance, I'd love to get to, you know, pick your brain a little bit if you want to get something to eat afterwards and have a drink." And that's actually what we did. And we became great friends. And this is the guy that slept over my house. We went to events together. We split hotel rooms covering shows. He's one of the best journalists. He's one of the hardest working. That's why he's so successful the way he is. And as a friend, I'm proud of all the things he does. Anyways, I just want to talk about this. And the reason why I wanted to mention all that stuff is I just want to mention that, I mean, I'm talking about how Nolan's my friend. And before I think of him as a journalist, I think of him as a friend. And I think that's, it's just a part about being human. And that's where we are right now. There's no predictions to be done because there's no events. If you see 249 at this time when I record next week, it seems like it's still going to happen. I will make predictions for that. So the third segment of next week's will be predictions. But in the meantime, I just want to say, like, guys, be good to people. Let's be good to people. Let's try to do our part in this. Let's try to get out of this. I know it sucks to be stuck in your house and not be able to go to a restaurant, not be able to go to a bar, and not be able to enjoy yourself, as Nolan was saying to me off the air, that, you know, maybe we'll appreciate things better now than knowing that how much it sucks to lose these things. Guys, please be safe. Try to do your part. Listen to the experts. If they say wear a mask, wear a mask. They say wear gloves. They say stay away from the elderly. Try to stay away from the elderly. I mean, guys, let's do this together. Like I said in the first thing, I'm not an expert, but I just hope we can all do our part. If we work together, from social distancing, we can beat this pandemic, move back to our normal life, and that's what we want. So, guys, I'll be back next week. I don't have a special guest yet. I'll get somebody. And if we have an event, I'll make predictions. So, guys, stick around. I'm sorry, I shouldn't say stick around. But, guys, I'll be closing the show. But make sure you check out all the rest of the shows. There's too many names, but there's so many shows on LoudMouth MMA. Obviously, we have a little less workload, a little less content than we normally do based on not having events. But we're still putting out like 6 or 7 different shows a week. Make sure you hit like on this. Make sure you share it, subscribe, do all that good things. I'll be back next week. Thanks for listening.